الحمد لله الحنان المنان، الحمد لله بالإيمان، والحمد لله بالإسلام، والحمد لله بالقرآن. اللهم لا نحصي ثناء عليك، أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. ونصلي ونسلم على قدوتنا وحبيبنا وقرة عيننا محمد النبي الأمين سيد وادي عدنان، وعلى آله ذوي الزلفى والعرفان، وعلى أصحابه ذوي التقى والرضوان، وعلى كل من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم السرور والحبور، يوم يفرح المؤمنون بجنة الرحمن. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم من علينا بالفهم، ومن علينا بالعلم، ومن علينا بالعمل، وألحقنا بعبادك الصالحين. It's very important before every lesson that we do that we implore to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with knowledge, and then to give us understanding, and then to help us and aid us to act upon our knowledge. Before I begin with the lesson, I read something today in the news that really made me proud of a particular person. That person is the Turkish leader, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless his soul, and also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant him paradise. For this man, he's the only person that spoke publicly today against the ban of the niqab in France. And he spoke about it, and he said that this is an act of discrimination that cannot be accepted. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide us with leaders that fear Allah subhanahu and that work for his religion and that don't work against his religion. Allahumma ameen. طيب. I would like to begin my class or my lesson tonight inshallah with a question that I want to pose to you. What is the greatest wish for a person of faith? I'm asking you. What is the greatest wish of a person of faith? Now, simple. The greatest wish for a person of faith is for him to be rewarded for his faith, for his belief. Me and you as Muslims, as people that believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that follow the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our greatest wish is for us to achieve success after our death, and for us to enter into the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is truly the greatest wish. However, there are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed with something that is a bit more special than this. It is one thing for a person to be successful, and it is another thing for a person to become a role model, an exemplar for others. There are people, and these are the people that have the best gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are the ones that they become a source of pride for the Lord. They become a source of pride for the guide. They become a source of pride for the Prophet. And this is really the greatest wish that a person of faith can ask for and can work towards. There are people, and we all have been in schools and we all have been in classes, that study and succeed. And they pass. Whoever passes, he moves on to the next class or he graduates, whether university, whether TAFE, whether school. And there are people who become first, and therefore they win the admiration of their teachers. So the one that comes first is not like the one that passes. And the one that is admired by his teacher is not like the one that just meets the standards. And from the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon some people is that they were praised and admired by their teacher and by their guide before they even saw him or spoke to him or heard from him. And that is special. When your source of guidance, your teacher, praises you and is proud of you before he even lays eyes on you, he sees from you or he hears from you. And that sounds unique. And that is the ultimate wish that a human can ask for. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from his mercy, gave that glad tiding to some of his creation. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the hadith is found in Bukhari and Muslim, and many of us know the hadith, written by Abdullah, was asked the question, Ya Rasulullah, Ayyun nasi khair? Which are the best of people? So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered and said, Khayrun nasi qarni, thumma alladhina yalunahum, thumma alladhina yalunahum. He said, the best of people are the people of my generation, my time, and the ones that come after them, and the one that comes after them. Meaning the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this blessed hadith, he specified three generations, and he classified them. And of course, the classification of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a classification from who? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. Because it does not speak from his own lust. He classified the best of people into three generations. The generation of the Sahaba, the generation of those who came after them, who are known in the Islamic sciences as At-Tabi'een, and the generation that comes after them, who are known in the Islamic terminology as Tabi'i, At-Tabi'een. And he said, these people are the best of people. And the hadith and the narrations of the hadith are all authentic and cannot be questioned. So it's a sealed hadith from the words of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks to us, we ought to listen and we ought to reflect. Is this hadith just a glad tiding for the tabi'een and for tabi'at tabi'een? And how wonderful is it for a person to win that praise from the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before he even meets the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And that's what I mean when I said that is the greatest wish that a person of faith can ask for. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his mercy has granted it to these two generations after the generation of the companions. So the question is the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only making a statement, giving us news, or is there something further than this that the Rasul would want us to benefit? Because the words of the Rasul are not only for his time, they are for the people until the day of judgment. The ulama said from the benefits that we earn from this hadith is we are establishing the status of people. So when the Rasul tells you that these are the best of people, that means we have to respect them. And we have to admire them. And we have to give them the virtue and we have to give them the status. You cannot treat someone from that generation like you treat your friend. Or like you treat your local sheikh. These are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger has favored upon others. And has placed above others. That's one. The second thing is that we see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving us models for guidance. If you want to imitate, if you want to learn, then look at these people because they are the best of people. When your teacher tells you, this is the best student that I have, and you are a student, then what does this mean? That means look at him, learn from him. See, why is he special? Why has he earned that status? And then follow from him. The generation of the Tabi'een, and that's why the title of our lecture today or tonight is Glimpses from the Life of the Tabi'een. We are actually going to look at one of the personalities And we're going to highlight some of the events that took place in the life of one of them. May Allah have mercy upon them. The generation of the Tabi'een is a generation that the Muslims today, in the 21st century, do not know much about. We've heard about a lot of companions, but we have not heard enough about the generation of the Tabi'een. And we have not heard enough about the generation of the Tabi'een, Tabi'i Tabi'een. If, and that is a great ni'mah upon the companions of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, if Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala blessed the companions to have the honor of compiling the Quran in one volume, then know, my brothers and sisters, that the generation of the Tabi'een had the honor of collecting the Sunnah of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his hadith from the chests of men and the put in volumes. And that is a much harder task to be performed. Now that the generation of the Tabi'een and Tabi'at Tabi'een are the ones who were responsible for founding the academic sciences in Islam, that the Muslims benefited from for generations and will continue to benefit from them until today. They are the ones who set the schools of tafsir in the different cities. They are the ones who set the different schools of hadith. They are the ones who set the different schools of the sciences of hadith. They are the ones who founded the science of usul fiqh. They are the ones who founded the science of ulum al-Quran. They are the ones who founded the science of ulum al-hadith. So we owe a lot to these people. And we have to learn from them. Because if the companions were too perfect, and there were people that were raised by the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then the Tabi'een, they show you the second best, a generation that came after the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Knowledge of Islam flourished during the period of these two generations. And we owe them a lot. And therefore we have to reflect over the actions. Whenever you feel lost, being in the 21st century, 1,432 years away from the time of the revelation of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the Hijri calendar, if you feel lost, if you feel confused, that the people around you, they're not giving you the truth, or that the people around you are not guiding you properly, then go back to the life of these men and see how they understood their religion and practice it like they practiced it. Because these men have a certificate that no other man on the face of the earth after the prophets has. And that is the certificate of piety and excellence in the religion of Allah. In understanding the religion of Allah, in preaching the religion of Allah, and in applying the religion of Allah, and in being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the Tabi'een, one of the unique people from the Tabi'een, is a person that the East and the West consent that he is from the best scholars of Islam. All the sects, all the groups of today and in the past do not argue when it comes to the piety and to the knowledge of that man. So he is one that has been able to achieve what no one else has been able to achieve. He is a man whose mother is a slave and whose father is a slave. Yet he, rahimahullah, was treated better than the kings of the world. And the kings of the world would seek his pleasure rather than him seek their pleasure. His name is Al-Hasan. His name is Al-Hasan ibn Yasar. And he is known publicly as Al-Hasan al-Basri. Al-Hasan al-Basri. Al-Hasan's mom, her name was Khaira. And she was a slave of one of the wives of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, her mother, Salama, radiallahu anha. And then later on she was freed by Umm Salah. And his father was Yasar, and he was a slave of the great companion who was responsible for compiling the Quran in one volume. Who was the companion? Was Zayd ibn Thabit. He was a slave for Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu. Now the interesting thing, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, is that Zayd himself was a slave. Yes? A slave for who? To Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what is interesting to note is that Zayd, unlike any other slave, chose to be a slave. Usually people are either born into slavery, or they get caught, or there is a debt, and then they become slaves, and they're not happy. But Zayd is a person that chose slavery. Because Zayd was given as a gift to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by his wife, our mother Khadija radiallahu anha. And that was before the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was honored with the message, was receiving the revelation. And Zayd, he was a young kid that was stolen from a caravan, and then he was brought to Mecca, and then they bought him, he became a slave. And his father looked around, I don't want to spend a lot of time, until he found him. He knew that his son is in Mecca, so he brought a lot of wealth, a lot of money, and he went down to Mecca intending to free his own son, and they came, they asked, they said he is with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Zayd is my son, and he was not born into slavery. He was captured from a caravan, and that's how he became a slave. And now I want to free my son. So name your price. Name your price, and I'll give it to you, and I want to have my son back. That is before the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became what? The messenger. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, he is yours. If he wants to go with you, and I would not want any money from you. And you can have him for no cost. But ask him, would he go with you? So Zayd, facing his father and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there, was given a choice. His father said, come to me, come with me, I'm your father, you know, and this is your uncle, this is your cousin, we are a respected tribe, you'll be free, you'll be, you know, a leader in your tribe. He said no. He said no. I want to remain a slave of Muhammad. Before he knew that he's a prophet. The reason why I mention this, and I want to note on it, is to show you what kind of character the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had before he even was a messenger or a prophet. And what kind of impact he had on people before the message that was sent to him. That caused the hearts of someone that is given a choice between being a slave and a free man to choose for him to be a slave. Just to be in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So imagine what kind of man was he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Yasar, the father of Al-Hasan, was a slave for Zayd ibn Thabit, and then Zayd ibn Thabit freed him. When Khayra and Yasar, the parents of Al-Hasan, were freed, they got married. And after they got married, they had the first child, and that was Al-Hasan. And Al-Hasan was born 2 years before the assassination of Umar radiallahu anh. Now, Khayra is free, so she has her own life. And Yasar is free, so they have their own lives. They're not connected to their masters anymore. Salama, our mother, she kept in contact with Khayra and would always check on her. And when she knew that she's pregnant, she actually asked, she kept on asking about her until she knew that she delivered. As soon as she knew that she delivered, what she did, she asked for Khayra and for the baby to be brought to her house. Why? Because she wanted to care for her. She's now in the period of nifas. She needs help. So Umm Salama said, come, you stay with me, and the baby stays with me, and I will look after you. And subhanAllah, when you hear this, you don't think that this is the type of slavery that was practiced in the world. You know, in the Romans and Europe and in the West. That's not something that you've heard before. You know, a master helping someone that was a slave for him or for her. and bringing them into the house and caring for them, this sounds more like mother, more than a master. So Khayra brought her baby and she came to the house of Umm Salama radiallahu anha. And then Umm Salama asked her, أسميت الغلام? Have you named him yet? So Khayra said, لا يا أمة. تركت الأمر لك. You know, no, I didn't name him. I left the matter, a mother, يا أمة. Because I left the matter to you. I want you to name my child for me. So Umm Salama radiallahu anha, she grabbed him and then she looked at him and she said, نسميه على بركة الله الحسن. We will name him with the blessing of Allah, inshallah, الحسن. And that's how this baby got his name. And he was blessed. And then ورفعت يديها له ودعت له بصالح الدعاء. And then she lifted her hands and she made دعاء. She made good دعاء for this baby. Now, Khayra, being a pious Muslim lady, what she did is that later on, she took her baby and she will go to the companions and she will ask them to actually make dua for her baby. And one of the people that made dua for that baby before his death is Umar radiallahu anhu. She brought him to Umar and said, please, that's my new baby. Could you please make dua for him? And Umar made a beautiful dua for him. He said, Allahumma faqihu fi al-deen wa habibhu ila al-nas. He goes, Allah, give him the understanding of your religion and make him beloved to the hearts of people. And Al-Hasan and his mom was actually brought up in the household of Umm Salama radiallahu anha. And how beautiful is that? For a baby, for a child to grow in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. How would you imagine the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to be? And how would you imagine would be the product of someone that is brought up and disciplined by the wives of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who are the mothers of all the believers. And what is interesting is that whenever Khayra would want to go out and do something, whether she wants to get to the market or whatever affairs she has, she would bring the baby and put him in what? In the house of Umm Salama. So Umm Salama, the master, became a babysitter for Al-Hasan. And not only she cared for his mother, but she became the babysitter of Al-Hasan, rahimahullah. And sometimes he'll be restless. And sometimes he'll be hungry. Back then there were no bottles. There's no S26. Okay? So she looks at him, what am I going to do with him? And Umm Salama is old. No more kids. So actually, she decided to make him suckle on her breast. Give him something just... You know, fool him, he'll get quiet. Because what should happen is that no milk should come out. Because she doesn't have any other babies, she's not breastfeeding. So she would give him her breast just to keep him quiet. But subhanAllah, by the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the breast of Umm Salama became filled with milk. And that baby was suckled by Umm Salama radiallahu anha. Subhanallah. You know, if you take any child to any lady, any, she doesn't have kids, no matter what he does, nothing will happen. But from the miraculous love and connection that was there, Allah blessed Al-Hasan to drink from the milk of Umm Salama radiallahu anha. And therefore she became not only his mother of faith, but she became Ummuhum Narza'a. She became his suckling or his nursing mother. And there's something that is greater than that. Now technically in Islam, when a child is nursed from a lady, then this lady becomes his mother from nursing, and the husband of that lady becomes his father from nursing. So Al-Hasan technically was blessed to become what? A son in suckling of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became Abuhum Narada. Because who's the wife of the Rasul? Who's the wife of the Rasul? Umm Salama, and she's the one that suckled him. Some of the ulama, they say that this milk that he drank is what gave Al-Hasan the piety that he had. Because this gave him a close link, a direct link to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he was brought up in the house of Salama, and all the wives of the Rasul would have the share in him. So he'll go to the, you know, house of Salama and the house of the other wives of the Rasul. And he himself speaks about that, how he used to play and fool around and sometimes climb up on the roof. So he was brought up in the house. And he stayed until 14 years old, until he became 14 years old, and then after that he left. Oh, he was taken away from Medina. Yani, subhanAllah, imagine your mother being a wife of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or actually the wives of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Tabi'een, one of the reasons why they are special is because they made contact with those that laid eyes on the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's it. Yani, if you see one of the companions, you learn a hadith from him, that's the only time you see him, you go away, you die, on a state of bliss, you are a Tabi'i. How about if you are brought up in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What does that mean? What kind of person would you be? And that's why the ulama say that Al-Hasan did not only take knowledge, but he took ethics and piety from the houses of the wives of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He learned from there how to pray. He learned from there the meaning of salah, the meaning of sadaqah, the meaning of being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Salama radiallahu anha, she was not just a normal woman. She was a very intelligent woman. And she's the one that the Rasul Sallam consulted when the problem of Umrah took place. When they went to Umrah and the Naga Umrah, the Rasul consulted her. So, and she is one of the wives of the Rasul Sallam that narrated, alone by herself, 387 from the hadith of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And she was a great woman of piety as well. So this knowledge was forwarded to Al-Hasan on a golden platter. And not only did he learn from Salama and the wives of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he also learned from the companions. He learned from Uthman ibn Affan. He learned from Talha ibn Ubaidillah. He learned from Amran ibn Husayn. He learned from Abdullah ibn Abbas. He learned from Samurah ibn Jundub. He learned from Anas ibn Malik and many other companions. So that man, Al-Hasan, became what? A gold mine of knowledge. However, the ulama of Sirah, they say there was one man that had a further impact on the personality of Al-Hasan. That man was the most beloved to him from the companions of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he was very fond of him and he was very close to him. He was his role model. That man was Ali ibn Abi Talib, the brother-in-law of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the cousin of the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Ali ibn Abi Talib was the model of Al-Hasan al-Basri. So he took from him his excellence in judging. He took from him his steadfastness in religion. He took from him his courage at the time of fight. And he took from him his disregard to the dunya. And this stayed like this until the time when his parents moved. And then from there he moved to the city of Kabul in Afghanistan. And then he moved from there to the city of Al-Basra, which is a city in Iraq. And there he settled. And he never left after that. Hence they call him Al-Hasan Al-Basri, the Hasan of the city of the Basra. That's how he earned this name. Of course, we learn from this that we as Muslims, we should have someone as our exemplar, as our role model. Because this will help you achieve what you want to achieve in your life. So, Al-Hasan moved on to the Basra and he lived in it and he continued seeking knowledge until he became one of the main scholars of the city of the Basra. And you're talking about a time, not like our time, someone has a small amount of knowledge, he's praised. No, you're talking about a time where people are very competitive. The level of knowledge that is spread is very high. So he became undisputed the scholar or one of the main scholars of the city of Al-Basra. And he was an imam in every sense of the word. Not imam in salah, no. An imam in his knowledge, an imam in his ethics, an imam in his behavior, an imam in his worship and in his زهد. That's why, despite, and that's why I said what I said earlier, despite whatever sect that you may think of following, and whether you are a person that loves the people of worship, or you're a person that loves the people of knowledge, whenever you look at the biographies, you'll find the name of Al-Hasan al-Basri there. So if you look at the biographies of the ulama, his name is there. And if you look at the biographies of the people of worship and the saints, then his name is there. And if you look at the biographies of those who are known for jihad, his name is there. One of the leaders of the Muslims, I don't want to speak about everything in his life, but I'll just mention that short thing. Whenever they were in the battlefield, I think his name was Muhallab, what he will do is that whenever the fight is strong, he will push Al-Hasan to the beginning, to the front of the army. Because the way that he fought was not normal. And he used to fight so courageously that if there is a problem in the front rows, the esteem of the fighters gets boosted. How he used to fight, rahimahullah. That's how courageous he was. And that doesn't surprise me if his role model was Ali radiallahu anhu. He became such a man of knowledge that the companions of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised him. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu said, سَلُوا الْحَسَنْ فَإِنَّهُ حَفِظَ وَنَسِينَ. People come to Anas ibn Malik, the servant of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He will say to the people, go to the Hassan and ask him. For he memorized and we have forgotten. And that is one of his teachers. Abu Ja'far al-Baqir, who is one of the scholars of Al-Bayt and one of the scholars of Islam from the household of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when someone asked him about Al-Hasan, he said, هذا الذي أو ذاك الذي يشبه كلامه كلام الأنبياء. Because you ask me about a man whose speech is similar to the speech of prophets. So, what kind of man was Al-Hasan? Taking you back into the issue of fiqh, that's why some ulama, they accept the hadith of Al-Hasan even if it does not mention the name of the companion. Because some of the companions would refer people to him before them. They will say, he knows, he remembers, and we have forgotten. That's why some ulama, like Imam Shafi, rahimahullah, and others, would accept the hadith of the mursal of Imam Hassan. Now some people say, no, we don't accept the hadith. طيب, you don't accept the hadith. But mention why the ulama accepted this hadith. That man became a moving city of knowledge by the agreement of the companions of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He was someone that, yani, and that is a sensitive topic, or sensitive point. He was not someone that liked the dunya. And that's a bit hard to mention in a society like our society. Once a man came to ask for the hand of his daughter. And Hamid al-Tawil was the messenger. He was the one that is, you know, Abit Wasat, you know, he's making, interceding for the man. So he started telling him, you know, Fulan is a young man and he's good and, you know, pious and so on and so forth. So Hassan was about to accept. So Hamid, once thinking that he's praising the man and giving him more credit in front of the Hassan, he said, إِنَّ لَهُ خَمْسُونَ أَلْفَ dirham. Do you know how much he has? He has 50,000 silver coins. What does he think he's doing? He is thinking that he's doing the man a favor. Now Al-Hasan is going to, and of course when someone, and 50,000 silver coins back then is like 500,000 today. So he's thinking that now the Hassan is going to say, MashaAllah, very good, come. I'll convince my daughter, don't worry, she likes you or not. I'll convince her. Al-Hasan looked at him and said to him, I will not accept him. مَا جُمِعَ خَمْسُونَ أَلْفَ دِرْهَمٍ مِّنْ حَلَالٍ. Because it's not possible for someone to gather 50,000 dirham from halal. This man has engaged in haram. I don't want him for my daughter. Hamid is shocked. Said, no. He goes, wallahi ma arifthu illa musliman wa la. He goes, wallah, what I know from the man is that he's, you know, pious. He's Muslim. He's good. So Al-Hasan went quiet and then he said to him, إِن كَانَ قَدْ جَمَعَهُ مِنْ حَلَالٍ فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يُؤَدِّ فِيهِ حَقَّهُ. Because even if he collected this money, this wealth from halal, there are some rights that he might have, He must have neglected. والله لا أجعل بيني وبينه صهرا أبدا. He goes, but Allah, I will not let someone like this ever be my brother-in-law. And that man was rejected because he's rich. have you ever heard of this today? When people propose, when young men propose, the first thing, do you have a house? First thing, okay, what kind of car do you drive? How much do you earn per week? You know, if these questions are not answered correctly, the door is waiting for you. That man, subhanAllah, Al-Hasan, he kicked out that man, even though he's pious, because he was wealthy. Look how our standard of measurement changed. Look how they used to think and how we think. He said, no, too much money. Too much money, there is doubt in your wealth. No, you can't be my, you know, my son-in-law. Can't be my sir. That mountain of iman, as subhanAllah, the qadr of Allah does, lived in the time of some of the most or the worst tyrants of the Muslim world. I'm talking Muslim world back then. I'm not talking today. Okay? In their time. He was at the time where Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi became a governor. Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi is one of the most notorious tyrants and slayers of Islam. And I've given a lesson about his life before, inshallah, but not here in JRC, a couple of years ago. Inshallah, I'm intending on doing it again here. He was a number one slayer and tyrant in the Muslim world by the consensus of the ulama. Al-Hasan lived in his time. And Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik also was the Khalifa. And he was a tyrant as well. So Al-Hasan lived in their time. And subhanAllah, from the qadr of Allah, is that confrontations has to take place between these people. Between tyrants and scholars and saints. So Al-Hajjaj, I can say from his bad luck, became the governor on the city of Basra and Kufa. Who's living there? Hassan al-Basri, Muhammad ibn Sirin, Shabi. Talking about the generation of the Tabi'een, great scholars. They did not give him a break. Whenever he will do something that is bad, they'll be there and they'll be speaking against him. Nothing he does except that he'll be attacked by Sa'id ibn Jubayr, by Muhammad ibn Sirin, by Hassan al-Basri, by Shabi. They'll straight away. A lesson will be made and they'll speak about him publicly. And he has done bad, you know, and he's bad, and he's, and they'll explain whatever he's done, and they'll, you know, they'll warn him from the punishment of Allah. One day, one of the incidents that took place is that Al-Hajjaj, he built a massive castle, beautiful castle, in the city of Wasit, which is between Basra and Kufa. Massive one. Like the castles that are built today. And after it was finished, after they finished constructing it, beautiful, you know, piece of architecture, he asked his people and his servants to open it to the public so the people would walk in and say, oh, wow, that looks, man, that's beautiful. Who, that belongs to the Hajjaj, mashallah. So he opened the place and he asked his servants to actually tell the people from the Basra and from the Kufa and from the cities to go to the city of Wasit and to do what? To ponder over the castle of Al-Hajjaj. The news reached Al-Hasan. Perfect opportunity. So Al-Hasan, he left the Basra and he went away to the Kufa. He walked into the castle, or the court of the castle, and the place is filled up with people. And he is known. He got up and he began to speak. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending his salah and salam on the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لقد نظرنا فيما شيد أخبث الأخبثين فرأينا أن فرعون من قبله قد شيد أفضل مما شيد وأعلى مما شيد ثم دمر الله فرعون ودمر ما شيده. He said, and he's in his castle, so he's looking to the people and saying, we can see what is the filthiest of the filth. referring to the Hajjaj, have built, and he's parading to us. And we know that Pharaoh before him has built something that is bigger than what he has built, and something that is higher than what he has built. And we know that Allah destroyed Fir'aun, and he has destroyed what he has built. Opening statement. That's not the end. That's just opening statement. فَلْيَعْلَمِ الْحَجَّاجِ أَنَّ أَهْلَ السَّمَاءِ مَقَتُوهُ وَأَنَّ أَهْلَ الْأَرْضِ غَرُّوهُ. Let the Hajjaj know that the people of the heavens hate him, and the people of the earth are deceiving him. And he continued to speak on that level of speech, on that type of speech. Attack, attack, attack. Until the people around him, because the Hajjaj will kill you if you blink next to him. If you blow your nose next to Al-Hajjaj, he will kill you. That is enough excuse for him to kill you. How about if you mention his name wrongly? How about if you call him the filthiest of the filth? So the people loving Al-Hasan, they became scared for him. So they began to say to him, after a while, said to him, Hasbuka Abu Sa'id. Hasbuka Abu Sa'id, enough, you know. Enough Abu Sa'id. That was his kunya, Abu Sa'id, enough. You said enough. They are fearing for their scholar. So he said to the person that said to him, Wayhak, قد أخذ الله ميثاق أهل العلم ليبينه للناس ولا يكتمونه. Allah has taken a vow upon the people of knowledge for them to share the truth to the people and not to hide it and not to conceal it. And he continued to speak like this until he had enough, رحمه الله. Then he went to his house. Now I ask you a question. Would you prefer a life of freedom over being a slave for a man like Al-Hasan? Wallah, I would love to wash his feet and be a slave for a person like this. He finished and he went back home. As if nothing happened. Now thinking, SubhanAllah, today we get a couple of phone calls, we are shaking. The news reached Al-Hajjaj. And Al-Hajjaj, he told off the people in his court so bad, and he became so enraged that everyone there was trembling. He said to them, tubban lakum wa suhqa. He goes, woe to you and may you destroyed. عبد من عبيد البصرة يقول فيها ما يقول ولا تقفون له. He goes, a slave. Now he's not a slave. But his father, his mother and his father were what? Ex-slaves. So he's putting him down. He goes, a slave from the slaves of the Basra. He dares to speak about me? And he stays alive? And he didn't do anything about him? Call him to me. Wallahi لأسقينكم من دمه. I swear by Allah, I'm going to make you drink from his blood. He called the executor, like the ones watching TV, with a sword, and they have something called a nata. A nata is like a piece of leather they actually spread, so when they chop the head, the blood does not go everywhere, okay, so they can contain it. Because he doesn't want to kill him in the cell. He wants to kill him in front of him, in his court. Because I'm going to make you drink from his blood. Get him for me. So they went and they summoned the Hajjaj, they summoned Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, and they brought the executor and everything was ready, and you know, the nata and the sword, and they brought him. He's outside the court. Like the massive doors that you see today, there's always hajib. Hajib is like a secretary. You know, whoever wants to go in has to get permission first. So the hajib went in. And he said to the Hajjaj, Hassan is outside. He goes, bring him in. Al-Hasan stepped in and he looked. And by the way, Hassan was not a small man like me. He was actually, mashallah, you know, a big scholar. They say his arm was like this. Big man. He walked in and he saw the executor, and he saw the sword, and he saw the leather, so they knew that he wants to kill him. So what he did, he just went like this. That's it. And did not speak to Al-Hassan, did not speak to the Hajjaj. And he stood in his place. Hajjaj looked at him and said to him, Udnu minni, come close to me. So he came close to him. Everyone's watching. And I said to him, come close to me, Udnu minni. And he kept on telling him, come close to me, come close to me, Al-Hassan, Al-Hassan will come. Because back then, like, there's a massive chair here, and what they used to do, they used to have chairs, all right, on the sides. So when they walk in, like, you see, in a particular spot, in the chairs. So he kept on getting Al-Hassan close to him, until he sat with him next to him on the chair. He just wants to make him drink from his blood. All right? Don't forget that. And then he began to speak to him softly. And the people are amazed. And then he began to ask him questions about fiqh, about the ahkam. And Hassan steadfast and answering. And Hassan was very eloquent. And Hajjaj was a very eloquent person as well. He used to love Arabic and literature. SubhanAllah. Reminds you of Hitler. He was such a tyrant, but he loved art. Al-Hajjaj was such a tyrant, but he loved poetry and literature. Al-Hassan would answer him, would say whatever he has to say, and then he'll be quiet. And he will say to him, Al-Hajjaj, Hani alaka ya Aba Sa'id. Congratulations to you, Aba Sa'id. And then after he asked him all the questions that he, on a way they came from, on a how they came to the mind of the Hajjaj, and after he finished, he looked at him and said to him, Anta Sayyid al-Ulama'i ya Aba Sa'id. He said to him, you are the sire, lord of the scholars of Aba Sa'id. Thumma da'a bi ghaliya, and then he asked, ghaliya is like, you know, a massive container where they used to keep the perfume. They used to keep the perfume, expensive perfume. And it was brought to him, and then he took the perfume and he perfumed the beard of Al-Hassan. He perfumed his bead, asked him for dua, and said to him, may Allah be with you. Leave. And Hassan left. Now the people, they're puzzled. Not even half a minute, he's going to kill him and he's going to make him drink from his blood. Then he gets him close, he sits him next to him, and asks him questions of fiqh as if nothing happened from before. And then he praises him, ya the, you know, Sayyid al-Ulama. And then he gets and he perfumes his bead, and then he says, there you go, Allah ma'ak. So the secretary, he figured out that there is a secret. And he remembered that Al-Hassan, when he saw the sword, and when he saw the executor, he mumbled something. He mumbled a few words. So as soon as he went out, he followed Al-Hassan. And he grabbed him. Not grabbed him like a policeman with a prison. No. Like, you know, like a servant in front of his master. Ya Sheikh, Ya Hassan. With all respect. He wanted to kill you. He wanted to kill you. I know he wanted to kill you. That's why I sent for you. I let you in because you are going to be dead. But he praised you. Why? What have you done to him? What do you think? A spell? Sounds like a spell? He said to him, you said something. What did you say when you mumbled? What did you say when you mumbled? He said to him, that sentence. He said to him, I said, Ya waliya ni'mati. What is he doing now? He's making dua. Wa ya kashifa kurbati. Ij'al naqmatahu alayya bardan wa salaman kama ja'alta an-nara bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. He began to address Allah. Oh Allah, who is the wali of my ni'mah? Oh Allah, you are the one who sustained me with the bounties that I have. And you are the one who relieves me from my hardships when I have them. وَيَا كَاشِفَ كربتي. Turn his rage against me. Make his rage against me cool and peaceful. Like the maid, like you made the fire on Ibrahim عليه السلام cool and peaceful. How long did that take place? How long did it take to say it? Less than a minute? That's it. The amazing thing is that the Hajjaj did not die. Something came, made him busy. Wallah, and I read it and I get astonished by the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and by the closeness of that saint to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Akhi, not even a minute. We make dua for hours. Nothing happens. Not even a minute to utter these words. It's not the Hajjaj got busy, something happened, he died. The Hajjaj himself turned in that moment, subhanAllah. Turned from an enemy to a friend. And perfumed his bead in his own hand. Now if I say to a brother, whenever you enter into a torrent and you say that dua, you say to me, where is your evidence? Okay? Well, my evidence is that the Hassan Rahimahullah has tried it and it worked. So we learn from the very best, we learn from them. May Allah have mercy upon them. That teaches us many lessons, brothers, and that's why I mentioned that story. That's why I made the whole lesson of the Tabain. That teaches us that worship, being a worshipper, does not mean that you move away from the field of da'wah. That means that being a person of knowledge and a scholar does not mean that you turn yourself back to the problems of the people. It does not mean that you don't say anything when you see tyranny before you. It does not mean that you stay quiet when you see oppression. You want to have spirituality? Have the spirituality of Al-Hasan, rahimahullah. That man, the ulama say that he was number one crying men. They said, Shahr ibn Hawshab said, there are two men that have not seen anyone cry from the fear of Allah as much as them. To the extent that I used to feel that these two men were created from the hellfire. Were created for the hellfire. And no hope of them being saved. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz and Al-Hasan al-Basri. Yet so much humbleness and piety and hatred to the dunya and so much peacefulness. When standing in the face of tyranny, he turns into what? He turns into a tsunami. He crushes everything that is in front of him. And that's what we learn from Al-Hasan, rahimahullah. I don't need to hear from Fulan, and I don't need to hear from Fulan. These people, Allah and His Prophet praised them. And told me that they are the best. So if I want to learn, I will learn from them. So you're a worshipper. Does not mean that you turn away from the problems of your society. You are a person of knowledge, does not mean that you are quiet when you see oppression taking place around you. You stand up to it, and you correct it, and you are rewarded for what you do, inshallah. And let us not cover ourselves with the cloak of piety and worship and spirituality, and we use that as an excuse to ignore the fights that we have to fight. To protect the fate and the future of our religion and our people. Al-Hasan had another encounter with Al-Hajjaj. Now the brother saying, here we go. He hammered him again. A man came to Al-Hasan. And he said to him, you know, subhanAllah, yani, sometimes some men, some Arabs, yani, oh no, they have a different way of thinking. Said to her, Anti Taliq, and lam yakun al-hajjaj fi an-nar. He said, I said to my wife, you are divorced if the Hajjaj is not going to be in the hellfire. Okay, so now what he's doing, they call this talaq mu'allaq. Now he put a condition that she will be divorced if the Hajjaj is what? Is not in the hellfire. Now, and the man regret what he said. So he went to the Hassan, seeking what? Not a fatwa for the sixth time he wants to go back to his wife. No. First time. He said, I said to my wife, you are divorced if the Hajjaj is not in the hellfire. Oh, Sheikh, What do you say? Is my wife divorced? طيب. Now what do you expect to be said? حسن الحسن said to him, إن الحجاج فاجر فاسق. Because the Hajjaj is someone that is shameless and an open sinner and a tyrant. ولكن رحمة الله وسعت كل شيء. But the mercy of Allah encompasses everything. I cannot say to you that he's in the hellfire. لا إله إلا الله. Notice that in the beginning there was nothing personal between Hajjaj and Hassan. It's not that was something. It's not that he heard him and then Hassan got up and gave a khutbah against him. Nothing. Hajjaj never came next to the Hassan. But because he was someone that was oppressing the Muslims, Al-Hassan stood up to him. And don't forget that he was about to kill him. So on a personal level, Hassan should say, yes, he's in the hellfire and his forefathers are in the hellfire. Ruh, your wife is not divorced. But he didn't, because he was a person of knowledge, rahimahullah. He said to him, he's a fajr, he's a fasiq, he's this, he's that. He goes, but the mercy of Allah encompasses everything. I cannot say that. Oh no. He said, I don't know. I can't give you an answer for your wife. So the man left. Look at the level of knowledge. To Muhammad ibn Sirin. Muhammad ibn Sirin can say the co-equal of Hassan. And we're going to mention a story that relates to them. He asked him the same question. You know, such and such. Muhammad ibn Sirin said to him exactly the same words as Al-Hassan. He's fajr, he's fasiq, he's this, he's that. But the mercy of Allah encompasses everything. I cannot say definitely that he's in the hellfire. Then he went to a third man. His name is Amr ibn Ubaid. Amr ibn Ubaid was from the Tabi'een and he was also known to be an imam of worship. Okay, from the people of Zuhd and worship. Not as much as Hassan. But he was more special for his, you know, for his zuhd, for his worship. He looked at him and he said to him the same question. He said, Rahimahullah, subhanAllah, you know, you think of the words and they, you know the knowledge that they have. He said to him, إِنْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لِلْحَجَّاجِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَكَ ذِنَا بِمْرَأَتِكَ أَرْجِعْهَا. He said to him, if the mercy of Allah is going to encompass the Hajjaj, then Allah will not punish you for doing zina with your wife. Go back to her. See what Amr ibn Ubaid is talking about? If you think closely, Amr ibn Ubaid did not say something different than Hassan and Muhammad ibn Sirin. Rather, he looked at the mercy of Allah. He said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his vast mercy will forgive to someone like the Hajjaj with the massive sins that he's done, then he will not punish someone like you for that sin, which is, even though it's a major sin in comparison to what they have done, to what the Hajjaj have done, is nothing. Subhanallah, look at the knowledge. That man, Amr ibn Ubaid, used to sit in the circle of Al-Hassan al-Basri. Al-Hassan al-Basri used to have two circles. One circle in the masjid, where he teaches fiqh, hadith, and Quran, and one circle that was private for him in his house, where they will only speak about issues of zuhud, you know, and suluk, and being close to Allah, and spiritualities. And in that circle, not anyone was allowed to come. He selected for it the worshippers of the city of Basra, who would allow them in them, and one of them was Amr ibn Ubaid. And not a word that related to fiqh or hadith was allowed to be mentioned there. What I mean is, nothing that is allowed that relates to the academic, you know, the heart-hardening topics. The only thing that gets mentioned is worship, spirituality, contemplation over Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the love of Allah. And that circle was a part of Allah. So Amr ibn Ubaid was one of the people that were allowed in this particular circle. What do we learn from this? We learn from this that even though the Hajjaj was as bad as he was, but he did not commit disbelief. And since he did not commit disbelief, Al-Hassan will not call him a disbeliever. And will not say he is in the hellfire. Look at that wara. Look at that ability to distinguish between issues that are taking place in his time. He's not subjective. He's objective in his judgment. Today, subhanAllah, sometimes we hear scholars, they defend tyrants. Why? And attack Muslims. A small issue of difference between us, we magnify it. And we are ready to kill one another for it. Even though it does not go past being a sin. And many tyrannies take place before our eyes. And we stay quiet about it. That's not the way of these people. That's not the way of the scholars. And that teaches us that the issue of takfir is not a simple issue. It's not a small issue. And if Al-Hasan rahimahullah is not willing to call someone like the Hajjaj with the massive crimes that he has committed, a kafir, or treat him as such, then how about us treating our brothers who we disagree with on minor things worse than we treat our enemies? Is this the understanding of our ulama? Is this the understanding of the tabi'een? Yes, Al-Hasan did not rebel against Al-Hajjaj. And did not rebel against Sayyidina Abdul Malik. And they called him. Someone went out and they called him. Let's come join us. He said no. Why? Because despite all this oppression, this khilafah was still built on the Sharia. The laws of the Sharia were practiced. Not fully, but they were practiced. The jihad defending the Muslim land was there. Upholding the hudud of Allah was there. Upholding how the Muslim society should run was there. Marriage, business transactions, laws, criminal laws, inheritance, all this was implemented. But the war, there was a lot of oppression, a lot of shedding blood. Because of this, Al-Hasan did not go against him. Very good. But this is for the Hajjaj and Yazid ibn Abdul Malik when they were ruling with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not fully, but in principle it was they. Not when there are people that are fighting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a different issue. Second, this did not stop Al-Hasan from standing up to them. True or not?
No.
Yes, they rebel. Yes, because the Muslim ruler reading about the book of Allah. Tayyib. But do I let his mistakes go past?
No.
Who would dare to call a leader the filthiest or the filth? أخبث الأخبثين. Who would dare to say that word? Al-Hasan said like this and something more than this. Standing up to that tyrant. The only reason that I respect you is because you still rule by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You still uphold his book. That's what keeps you alive. But you are going, you are violating here. And you are this, and you are this, and you are this, and you should be stopped. That's when the leaders, brothers and sisters, used to fee the ulama. That's when the leaders, brothers used to fee the ulama. Because there were ulama that cannot be bought, cannot be sold. They'll speak the word of truth, no matter what it is. And that is the best type of jihad. That is the best type of courage. Not open claims. And we are nothing from inside, no. One of the words that was used to describe Al-Hasan is that فَعْلُهُ مِثْلَ قَوْلِهِ. His actions always match up his words. His actions always match up his words. And look how Allah looks after him. That short dua, خلاص, Hajjaj can't touch him, can't touch him. He's not allowed to lay hands on him. A lot of people know that Sa'id ibn Jubayr, the dua of Sa'id was the cause of the death of the Hajjaj. Some ulama say that even Al-Hasan made dua against him when he heard about the death of Sa'id. After that he died. A lot of stories and incidents that took place in the life of Al-Hasan. There's another one I wanted to mention, but it's too long and I know that you're tired. But I want to end my lesson, inshallah, with that story. Al-Hasan al-Basri and Muhammad ibn Sirin, were the best scholars. All right? A quarrel took place between them. Some misunderstanding, some disagreement. So they became upset with each other. So Al-Hasan would avoid Muhammad ibn Sirin. And Muhammad would avoid Al-Hasan. And whenever it was in the gathering of Al-Hasan, people, his students, his followers sitting in his gathering, they will mention Muhammad ibn Sirin, he will say that. He will say, Da'una min dhikri al-haka. Do not speak about those who weave. Now Muhammad ibn Sirin, his father, see the carpets and the clothes that we wear today, they're made by machines. Back then there were people that used to actually make them, you know, with simple instruments. They were called al-ha'ik. The one that has that trade is called al-ha'ik. That's why until now you have some Lebanese, they have the surname al-ha'ik and other ones, because that means someone in their ancestors used to do that trade. The father of Ibn Sirin used to work a ha'ik. And he would not want to say, don't mention his name. And there's someone big by him. So what does he do? He says, do not talk about who work in hiyaka. Indirectly. One day, Al-Hasan al-Basri sees a dream that shakes his heart. He wakes up and he calls his students and he sits and he says, I saw a dream. رجف له قلبي. My heart trembled to it. Khair, what did you see? He said, I saw myself naked. Standing on a dump of garbage. In my hand is a oud. Oud is like a guitar. Arabic guitar, right? And I'm playing it. So Al-Hasan thought, I'm going to the hellfire. That's why he was so scared. Now, who was the best person to interpret dreams? Now, the best person who interpret dreams is Muhammad ibn Sirin. So he said the dream to one of his students and he sent him to Muhammad ibn Sirin. Subtly, not telling him anything. Anyone walks in, Assalamu alaikum Shaykh, alaikum salam, I had a dream, tafaddal. So the student sat in front of Muhammad ibn Sirin and he said to him the dream. Ya Shaykh, what does that mean? Muhammad ibn Sirin looked at him and he said to him, do not talk about those who work in hiyaka. He does not know that he's his student. Yani I'm sitting here, someone walks in, I don't know him. He says a dream to me and he asks me to interpret. He goes, do not ask. Sorry, he said, do not talk. He said, do not ask those who work in hiyaka. The man did not understand. And the student, even when it was said in front of him, did not understand what Hassan meant by it. This guy says, do not talk about the people of Hayaka. And this guy says, do not ask the people of Hayaka. Hayatuni. He's confused. So he went back to the Hassan and he said to him, Al-Hassan's anxious waiting. What did he say to you? He said to me, do not ask the people of Hayaka. So Al-Hassan looked. I said, okay, get up. So he gathered his students and he went to Muhammad ibn Sirin. And he saw him and he shook his hand, you know, and they made up with, they reconciled with each other. And then they spoke, you know, I'm upset with you, how could you say this? You know, whatever problem was between them, they resolved it. And then Hassan grabbed the hand of Muhammad ibn Sirin and said, leave me from all this. Please tell me what does my dream mean? For my heart trembled from it, yeah, Muhammad. And I'm scared. And I feel like I'm going to the hellfire by that dream. He said to him, you being naked means you have nothing from the filth of the dunya on you. And the dump of garbage that you were standing on shows that that's how you see the dunya and you see the real value of the dunya. And the guitar that you are playing is the words of wisdom that you teach to the people. Now there's a lot of lessons to be learned. I don't say to you the story so you to get entertained, because I'm trying to teach you something, inshallah, me and you. First, that shows us that Allah does not give His full knowledge to anyone. Rather, He divides it between His servants. Al-Hasan, as great as he was, being in the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, being a man of piety and a man of courage and a man to stand to tyrants, being a person of wisdom, does not know how to interpret his dreams. Does not know how to interpret dreams. And that shows us that sometimes Allah can give special knowledge to some people to make them special, to favor them over others, and this is a ni'mah from Allah. So therefore, when we learn, we don't restrict ourselves to one. We learn from more than one. Who Allah blessed with what, we learn from Him. That's what this shows. The second thing is that we should not be fooled by our dreams. Some people think, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Akhi, you did not see the Prophet. Now you think that you saw the Prophet, but you didn't. I saw light, I'm going to heaven. I saw Sulaiman alayhi salam. I saw this, I saw that. People should not assume that they interpret dreams with the logic. No, you're wrong. Al-Hasan thought like this, and he was wrong. Who was able to interpret it? Muhammad ibn Sirin rahimahullah. Now the other question is, and that was on the mind of the Hassan, he said, so I'm safe. He said, yes. Your dream shows that you are safe. Nothing bad in it. Looks so bad, naked on a garbage dump, playing a guitar. Someone that cries from the fear of Allah when you wake up. How do you feel about yourself? He said to him, how did you know that was me? Because when the, does not the man, when he said to him the dream, does not know who he is. How did you know? Because this word, I say it. How did you know that this was me? Listen, subhanAllah, aren't they fighting with each other? Listen how they speak about each other. That's before he reconciled with him. He said to him, because such a dream, no one would see it except a person of piety. And you are the most pious that I know in the Basra. And you are the most pious that I know in the Basra. That's why when that man said it to me, inside, subhanAllah, the inside of the believer, that's Hassan, that's not you. That's not your level, step aside. Send me the ones that saw it. I saw this, no, that's not you. Give me the ones that saw it. And they made up from there. Yani, there's so many aspects in the life of the Hassan, and he selected two or three from his life that I wanted to highlight to show you the level and the type of scholars that we had. And to say that if we lack models today, then we have plenty from our past to go back to and to imitate and to learn from them. And whenever you get confused, go back to your ancestors, for you have the best of ancestors to learn from. People like Al-Hasan, and people like Muhammad ibn Sirin, and people like others. And Hassan deserves more than one lesson. That's any. I haven't mentioned everything about him. There's a lot of things that relate to him. Inshallah, if Allah allows us, we'll speak about it. But sometimes, wallah, even these stories, I don't feel I'm worthy of talking about a scholar of that caliber. You know? For you to speak about the people of knowledge, you have to be something similar to them. And we are very far from people like this. And see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him the karamat just like this, when they are in a situation where they need him. 1432 Hijri is our year. That's how much time separates us from them. But in reality, in our principles, in our understanding of Islam, in our application of our religion, I think we are light years away from them. And we need to go back to our roots. Not to initiate differences between each other, but to learn how to respect each other and how to live our religion the way that this man have lived it and have understood it. And that's the last words I say, inshallah. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
To listen to or download more Islamic lectures, please visit www.islamicmedia.com.au.